Such a blessing to be here tonight. I want to take this time to give honor to our prelate in the personality of Bishop Theodore Brooks. And I want to thank God for the Pentecostal Assemblies of the World for this opportunity to share the Word of God in our holy convocation. Zechariah chapter 2, verses 1 through 7, it reads like this. I lifted up mine eyes again and looked, and behold, a man with a measuring line in his hand. Then said I, whither goest thou? And he said unto me, to measure Jerusalem, to see what is the breadth thereof and what is the length thereof. And behold, the angel that talked with me went forth, and another angel went out to meet him and said unto him, run, speak to this young man, saying, Jerusalem shall be inhabited as towns without walls, for the multitude of men and cattle therein. For I, saith the Lord, will be unto her a wall of fire round about, and I will be the glory in the midst of her. Ho, ho, come forth and flee from the land of the north, saith the Lord. For I have spread you abroad as the four winds of heaven, saith the Lord. Deliver thyself, O Zion, that dwellest with the daughters of Babylon. I want to talk from this subject tonight, no more limitations. That is the word of God for you tonight. There shall be no more limitation. My brothers and sisters, the book of Zechariah is the longest book of the minor prophets, the most difficult to understand. One of the reasons for this difficulty is the numerous visions that call for an interpreter. At times, an interpreting angel is around the prophet to give him an understanding or to explain what the visions that God is showing him, what they mean. But at other times, there is no interpreting angel to give clarity to what it is the Lord is showing the prophet. It's going to take revelation and wisdom and knowledge to have better understanding of what it is God is trying to reveal to the prophet. One thing that makes the book of Zechariah significant for the Christian is the use of its prophetic word in the New Testament. Especially in the Gospels, as the Gospels refer back to the prophet Zechariah. It is this prophetic book that is the most quoted section, amen, of the prophetic books in the Gospel Passion narratives. And other than Ezekiel, Zechariah influenced the book of Revelations more than any other Old Testament book. The common name Zechariah most likely means the Lord remembers. This is very important to the understanding of this prophetic corpus. The Lord remembers, or the Lord is renowned. Zechariah is noted as the son of Birshiah, or the grandson of the prophet Iddo, proving Zechariah's prophetic Levitical lineage, letting us know that he comes from strong prophetic stock. He's a man of God that has grown up in the way. He knows how to function in the things that the Lord has called him to. I like this book as I begin to recall what the prophet's name means. The Lord remembers. The Lord remembers. The Lord remembers. That is very important, because we will find Israel in a place of hopelessness and despair. But it is the prophet Zechariah that begins to come up on the scene after the Lord has told the prophet Jeremiah that the children of Israel were going to be in bondage for 70 years. It is after the 70 years of bondage that Zechariah comes up on the scene as the mind of God that remembers that after your 70 years of bondage is over, the Lord's going to remember you, and he's going to pull you out of the hopelessness and the despair that you are in. My brothers and sisters, this is good news for us. The reason it is good news is because if the Lord has given you a word, he is faithful to recall and to remember the word of God that is on your life.
The Bible would recall to us that Zechariah remembers. He comes up in a time where Israel is in bondage, and because he remembers, he begins to speak the word of freedom and deliverance to the children of Israel. I wish I had time tonight, but I don't have time. If I had time, I would walk you, amen, from the first prophecy all the way up to the third. The first prophecy, amen, deals with the messenger or the theophany or Jesus Christ in the flesh, riding in the low place, riding in the ravine amongst the myrtle trees. And the Bible says that he's riding amongst the myrtle trees. And the reason he's riding in the low place amongst the myrtle trees is because he's trying to see what condition Israel is in. The prophet, first vision is Jesus in the Old Testament. That's what a theophany is. It is the hidden Christ in the Old Testament. Jesus in the Old Testament, he's riding on a red horse around or amongst the myrtle trees in the lowest place of the earth to let Israel know, I'm coming to pull you out of your low place. I'm coming to pick you up out of the places that have had you bound. I'm coming to pull you out of despair, and I'm coming to bring you into liberty. He says he's riding amongst the myrtle trees because I remembered that I said I was going to come get you once you've been in bondage. I remembered that I was going to come set you free once you've been in bondage. And I'm riding in the low place to let you know that no matter how low you get, the grace of God is still good enough to come and find Israel even in its low places. My brothers and sisters, after we see the first vision, we then see the second vision. The second vision shows us Zechariah looking out the window again. And when he looks out the window again, he has a vision of Israel being in the middle. And while Israel is in the middle, there are four sets of ram horns that are coming against Israel. Better yet, I'll say four sets, which equal eight horns. There is one set coming from the north, another set coming from the south, another set coming from the east, and another set coming from the west. And they're coming from the four corners of the earth to shred Israel into pieces. And while they're coming to shred Israel into pieces, the Bible says that God only sends Israel to battle with a hammer. Good God here. He only sends Israel to battle with a hammer. I ain't got time to park here, but often when I read this, I said, Lord, I've never seen you ever send, glory to God, someone to battle with a hammer. I've never seen you send someone to battle, amen, with just a piece of working tools that would build something. Most times when you send people into battle, you send them with knives and guns and stones and rocks, but you send Israel to battle, hallelujah to God, with a hammer. He says the reason I sent Israel to battle with the hammer is because I needed Israel to know the only way you're going to win in this season is not by fighting back. The only way you're going to win in this season is by keep building. Hallelujah to God. I don't know who I'm preaching to, amen, right here on today, but I stop by to encourage somebody that the way you're going to win is not by talking back, it's not by fighting back, it's not by trying to get the last word. But if you want to succeed in this next year, if you want to do better in year 2020, the way God is going to advance you is by building anyway. They're talking, but you keep building. They're scandalizing your name, but you open up another business. They said you weren't going to be nothing, but you expand yourself. Hallelujah to God. You let God fight your battles. And while God is fighting your battles, hallelujah, you're building, amen, what God is getting ready to do for you. You're building new territory. You're building new relationships. You're building, hallelujah, what God has put into your heart to build. Many times, the reason we have enemies is because our enemies are trying to distract us from our destiny. But I come back to encourage somebody and tell you, this is not the season to be distracted. This is the season to build amongst adversity, to build amongst naysayers, to build amongst witches, to build amongst warlocks, to build no matter what it looks like. Put your hammer in your hand and build anyway. Somebody
Somebody ought to just post it on this live right now. Tell them you talking, but I'm building.
As we dig into this third prophecy, my brothers and sisters, we see God handling caps and borders, or ceilings and gates. God is dealing with Israel's limitations. My brothers and sisters, limitations often speak to restrictions. Limitations often speaks to boundaries or lanes. And now you must understand, my brothers and sisters, I am one that believes in boundaries. I am one, my brothers and sisters, that believe in lanes. I believe, hallelujah, amen, in staying in your lane and staying in your boundary. I believe in boundaries because boundaries speak to your rim of success, or your area of growth, or better yet, your place of focus. Hallelujah. Especially in a time and a season where everyone wants to do everything. Please hear me when I tell you, amen, that your success is bound to your rim. Your success is bound to the place where God has put you. And many times, the reason many people are not successful is because they're too busy nibbling and dabbling in other people's rim, when you need to stay where God has placed you and planted you. But my brothers and sisters, every now and again, God will enlarge your territory. Hallelujah. When you've been faithful in your assigned area, God will enlarge your territory. I don't know who I'm preaching to, amen, on this live today, but I need to encourage somebody that's been faithful over a few. I need to encourage somebody that's been doing all you can to please the Lord. And I need to tell you to be encouraged, because when you've been faithful, amen, over your boundary, God will expand you. God will take you, amen, to greater places. It is your Bible that says, if you've been faithful over a few, he says, I'll make you ruler over many. Lord, I wish you were in here today, because if you were, I would tell you to give somebody a high five and tell them, get ready, because you're getting ready to be expanded. God, hallelujah. God's getting ready to enlarge you. God's getting ready to expand your territory. God's getting ready to take you places you never thought you could go. Let me talk to those who've been faithful. You've been faithful in serving. You've been faithful in doing what God told you to do. You've been faithful in the assignment that God has placed to your hands. And I need you to know tonight that because of your faithfulness, the Lord is getting ready to remove caps and borders, and he's getting ready to expand you. Here in our text, my brothers and sisters, we see Israel, a group of people that has been faithful through suffering. And now they're returning home to a place where God is getting ready to bless them. They've been in bondage. They've been in Babylonian bondage, and they've been faithful over the suffering that they've been in. Lord, I wish I had time, because I would tell you today, my brothers and sisters, that it's easy to be faithful when you're being faithful over something that is comfortable. But it is hard to be faithful when you're being faithful over the assigned suffering that has been placed on your life. Please understand, my brothers and sisters, I know that they have a new theology that tells you that you ain't gonna have to go through nothing. I know they got a theology that tells you you ain't never gonna have to suffer. I know they have a theology that tells you every day is going to be howdy howdy or peaches and cream. But I need somebody to know, amen, that that is not what our Bible teaches. You will have seasons of suffering. You will have seasons where you begin to go through. It is your Bible that says, for I recognize that the suffering of this present time, or the suffering of this season, is not worthy to be compared to the glory which shall be revealed. Hallelujah. You will suffer. You will suffer. You will suffer. But when you learn to be faithful over your suffering, when you learn how to be faithful over your Egypt, and faithful over your Babylon, and faithful over your wilderness, God can trust you with expanded territory. Oh, let me talk to somebody here. You may be going through a season of cancer. Be faithful even in that season. You may may be going through, amen, a season of sickness. Be faithful in that season. You may be going through a season of loneliness. I stop by to tell you to be faithful over your season of suffering. And when you get faithful over your season of suffering, and when you can go through that season successfully, then God can bring you to a place of celebration. And that is what we see happening with Israel in our text. The Bible says that Zechariah has a third vision. The Bible says he goes out, amen, he lifts up his eyes to see again, hallelujah, what the Spirit would begin to show him. And the Bible says that the Spirit showed him a field. And in this field, out yonder in the field, he sees an angel out there with the measuring line. He sees an angel with a big piece of measuring tape. And the angel is measuring the length and the depth, the length and the breadth of Israel. The Bible says that, wow, hallelujah, I feel you, Holy Ghost. The Bible says that while the angel is out there measuring the length and the depth, hallelujah, of Israel's return, the Bible says that in the vision, he sees another angel walking out into the field. And the Bible says that the angel walks out to the field and begins to speak to the man or the angel with the measuring line. And he tells the man, he says, stop measuring. Glory to God. He tells him, stop measuring. He says, and the reason I'm telling you to stop measuring is because what I'm getting ready to do for Israel cannot be measured. He says, what I'm getting ready to do for them is so big that you cannot contain it. He says, what I'm getting ready to do for Israel is so big, hallelujah, that you cannot bear it. He says, I'm bringing Israel to a place of expansion. Lord, can I speak to you prophetically? Hallelujah. And let me tell you, that is the word of the Lord for you, that God is getting ready to bring you into a place of healthy expansion. The text would suggest, amen, that Jerusalem shall not have any barriers. The Bible says that if they will return from the north and be faithful to God, he lets them know that I'm going to expand you greater than you've ever been expanded before. I don't know who I'm preaching to on this live on here today, but somebody ought to declare, when I get up out of what I'm going through, I'm not going back to what's normal, but I'm going back to what's bigger. I'm not going back to what's comfortable, but I'm going back to a place where God's getting ready to expand me greater than what I've ever been expanded. God's getting ready to give you what you can't measure. God's getting ready to give you what you can't put in a measuring cup and what you can't measure with a measuring line. God's getting ready to bless you so much that when you're trying to put a cap on it, hallelujah, your blessings are going to burst open the cap. You can't pull a ceiling on top of it. You can't put a border around it, because as soon as you try to cap me off, God's getting ready to expand me beyond that, and then expand me beyond that, and then expand me beyond that, and then expand me beyond that. Look at somebody, tell them, get out of my business. I know you're trying to figure out, when will I stop being blessed? It ain't none of your business when God's going to stop, because every time I turn around, he keeps on blessing me. I stop by to prophesy to you and tell you, get ready, because expansion. Is getting ready to come your way. Somebody declare, I shall be expanded. My 2021 is going to be my season of expansion. Oh! Now see it. my brothers and sisters, the imagery from chapter 1 up until chapter 2, it seems as if, hallelujah, glory to God, that Israel was already out of bondage. It seems like they have already come out of the despair of Babylon. But then, my brothers and sisters, if you keep on looking, it looks as if, hallelujah, they're no longer in bondage or they're set free. But what I can't understand is if they're out of bondage, why do they have to be asked to come home? Glory to God. The text says, it says, no, no. It says, ho, ho. It says, escape you people. Hallelujah. Out of Zion who live in Babylon. He says, get in your rightful place. And he says, I will expand you. In other words, he says, return to me like I need you to return to me so that I can expand you the way I need to expand you. He says, get in your rightful place. He says, stop seeing yourself in a low degree. Stop behaving like you're still in bondage. Stop behaving like you're still yoked up in the ungodliness. Stop behaving, hallelujah, like you're in a place, hallelujah, and I've already set you free of it. Many times we like to waddle in the residue of our past. We like to waddle in the residue of our struggle. We like to waddle in the residue of what we've been through. But I stop by to tell you, amen, that the Lord has healed you, that the Lord has set you free, that the Lord has brought you out of where you are. And I stop by to tell you, whom the Son set free is free indeed. You got to come out of that place, and you got to walk in it. Good God, who am I talking to in here? Somebody, look at somebody on this live and tag somebody and make them your neighbor and tell them, walk in your freedom. Tell them, walk in your liberation. Tell them, walk in your place of victory. Tell them, God's waiting on you. You ain't waiting on God. He's waiting on you. He's waiting on you to understand the favor that's on your life. He's waiting on you to understand the power that's on your life. He's waiting on you to understand the greatness and the grace that he has released on you. And he says, when you finally get it, you'll begin to walk into expansion. Oh, good God here. I'm trading my sorrow. Trading my shame, I'm trading my sickness, and I'm trading my pain, and I'm laying it down. Somebody holler, I'm walking in it. I know I can't hear you where I am, but I dare you in your house, hallelujah, make your whole street mad, and wave your hand and holler, I'm walking in my expansion. Text would suggest that they were afraid. They were in fear of expansion because they were wondering, Lord, if you expand me, will you protect me? But God says, don't worry about it, because when you come out of the bondage, not only am I bringing you to expansion, but I'm also bringing you to protection. The Lord has promised that he himself will be like fire. Good God here. The Bible says he will be, hallelujah, a fire-like wall around Jerusalem to protect it. And because he will live, watch me now, in the city will be powerful and great. He says, I will be the glory within her. In other words, the Lord's presence will be the source of the city's reputation. He will live there in all of his glory. My brothers and sisters, glory in this context probably refers to God's greatness and God's power rather than his radiance or his brightness. Many translators may say, for example, because I will live there, the the city will be powerful and great. My brothers and sisters, the text shows us the power of the indwelling of God. When God is strong within, hallelujah, he is stronger without. Let me say it again. When God is strong within, he is stronger without. God is our outer protection. My brothers and sisters, could it be the reason you feel like you have to fight every battle is because you have no confidence of the God within to handle it? And maybe, hallelujah, there's no confidence in the God within to handle it because we spend more time, hallelujah, watching what's going on outside of us instead of realizing how great the God is on the inside. My brothers and sisters, the text says, for behold, I will shake my hand upon your enemies, and they shall be a spoil to their servants, and ye shall know that the Lord of hosts have sent me. In other words, he says, don't be worried about those coming against you. He says, because as soon as they come against you, he says, I will raise my fist towards them. He says, and I will crush them. My brothers and sisters, the them are the nations that try to come and plunder you. In other words, what God's trying to tell Israel is, don't be worried about your enemy. Don't be worried about those, hallelujah, who come against you. We spend too much time in church praising our enemies. We spend too much time in church giving victory to Satan. We spend too much time in church glorifying what Satan can do. But the Lord will have me to tell you on tonight, he says, in this next season, he says, I don't want you worrying about the devil at all. I don't want you worrying about the enemy at all. I don't want you worried about the people that's trying to hinder you or fight you at all. This is not the time to look down. Glory to God. This is the time to look up. Glory to God. I said, this is not the time to look down. This is the season to look up. It is your Bible that says, no weapon that's formed against you shall be able to prosper, and every tongue that rises up against you in judgment, he says that God will condemn. It is your Bible, hallelujah, that lets us know that 1,000 shall fall at thy side, and 10,000 at thy right hand, but it shall not come nigh thee. Only with your eyes shall you behold and see the reward of the wicked. This is not the season where I'm magnifying my enemies. I'm not paying my enemies no attention. This is the season where I'm thanking God about how great I am down on the inside. My brothers and sisters, there's a story of a little boy. This little boy had a clown, and this clown didn't really sit on any legs. This clown was nothing but some plastic that the father had blown some air in. After he had blew up the dowel, he put the dowel up in his son's room. And then the job of the son was to hit the dowel. But every time the son would hit the dowel, or better yet, would hit the blow up dowel, it would go down and it would come back up. The son would hit it again, and it would go down and it would come back up. The son ran to the father and said to the father, he said, something's wrong with this thing you gave me. He said, every time I hit it, he said, it goes down, but for some reason it keeps on popping back up. The father looked at the son and said, son, the reason it keeps popping back up is because it doesn't matter what you do to the outside of it. It's because there's something down on the inside of it. He said, I blew the wind that was in me. And I blew it, hallelujah, into the plastic dowel. And because it had the wind of the
the Father it was able to endure the storms that came on the outside. I stop by to tell you, that's what the text is saying today. The text is saying, if you let God be big enough on the inside, the enemy may try to knock you down, but every time he knocks you down, you keep on popping up. I don't know who I'm preaching to in here today, but I need you to find that neighbor again on this live and tag them and say, neighbor, I'm being expanded. But tell them, not only am I being expanded on the outer, but tell them God is being expanded in me on the inner. And tell them he's so big in me that every time you knock me down, I keep on popping up. Sickness tried to knock me down, but I kept on popping up. Pain tried to knock me down, but I kept on popping up. Enemies tried to have their way, but the reason it never worked is because I've got something on my inside working on my outside. And oh, what a change he has made in me. I don't know who I'm preaching to today, but I stop by to tell you, if you're wondering what's on the inside of me, I come by to tell you what's on the inside of me is the greater of Jesus Christ. For my Bible would record that greater is he that's within me than he that's in the world. If you know you got greater in you, I can't hear you where I am, but I need you to scream at me, and I need you to holler, I got greater on the inside. And if I got greater on the inside, I've got protection on the outside, because I'm dwelling in the secret place of the Most High God. It is your Bible that says, he that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. You talked about me, but I'm dwelling in the secret place. You tried to scandalize my name, but I'm dwelling in the secret place. You tried to call me down, but I'm dwelling in the secret place. And when I'm dwelling in the secret place, you can't touch me, because the hand of the Lord is on my life. Yeah, his hand is on me. His hand is on me. His hand is on me. I'm closing now. Not only when you return, will you return to expansion. Not only when you return, will you return to protection. But lastly, when you return, you're returning to possession. Do you hear me today? The text would suggest that when you return, he says, Israel, don't return with your mouth shut. He says, but return with a praise in your mouth. He says, I need you to praise me, because you understand that the only reason you made it out of bondage is because of the grace of God that brought you out from one place to the next. And he says, Israel, when you get back into Jerusalem, he says, come back with a thank you in your mouth. He says, come back with a praise in your mouth.
worship in your mouth. He says, come back with hands that are lifted. He says, when you come back, I need you to have the attitude that I will bless the Lord at all times, and his praise shall continually be in my mouth. My soul shall make her boast in the Lord, and the humble shall hear thereof and be glad. And he says, Israel, as you begin to praise me, I'm going to expand you into greater possession. He says, souls are going to begin to come from the north, the south, the east, and the west. This portion of the text, starting at verse 10, it indicates that as Israel praised me, he says a new group of people are getting ready to come in. I don't know who I'm preaching to. I want to talk to you, and I want to tell you, whatever you do, don't lose your praise, because as you lift up Jesus, there's a new group coming. There's a group coming that don't look like you. There's a group coming that you ain't used to seeing. There's a group coming that's gonna be a little different. But God said that if you keep on praising me, I'm gonna bring them in. He says many nations shall join themselves. This indicates that the Lord's blessings will extend beyond the limits of what you knew. This lets us know that people of all genres are getting ready to come. He says, but all you gotta do is lift my name. If you praise God, God will begin to draw the people. But he says in his word, if I be lifted up, I'll draw men unto me. I stop by to tell you to be not dismayed. Whatever be your tide, God will take care of you. God, he's getting ready to expand your borders. God, he's getting ready to make room for you. God, he's getting ready to open the windows of heaven and pour you out a blessing. You ain't got room enough to receive. You suffered enough. But I hear scripture saying to not worry about your suffering, because after you've suffered a while, he says, I'll strengthen you, I'll establish you, and I'll make you perfect. I told you already that the worry about the hell that you've been through, for I recognize that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared to the glory which shall be revealed. I hear scripture saying, count it all joy when you fall in the time of temptation, knowing this, that the trying of your faith, 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 worketh patience.
patience, but let patience have its perfect work, because God, he's getting ready to take you to higher heights and deeper depths. He's expanding you to higher heights and deeper depths. He's moving you to higher heights and deeper depths. What you sown in tears, the Lord told me to tell you to get ready now. You're going to reap in joy. You're going to reap in joy. You're going to reap in joy. Joy is coming to you. Joy, like a river, is coming your way. Don't worry about what they said about you. Don't worry about those who left you. The Lord was making room for you so he could expand you. Expansion is coming now. Expansion is coming now. Expansion is coming now. Expansion is coming now. Oh, shucks now, y'all. You done made me feel like preaching. Please, look at somebody. Tell them, neighbor, get ready now. Here comes expansion. Move the walls. Move the camps. Move the ceilings. Move the borders. Because what God, he's getting ready to do to my life. You can't contain it. You can't contain it. You can't contain it. Yes. You can't contain it. Yes. You can't contain it. Yes. Bigger. Brighter. Better. Bigger. Brighter. Better. Bigger. Brighter. Better. Bigger. Brighter. Better. Say it. Say it. Say it. Say it. Bigger, brighter, better. You gonna put it on there. Put it on your screen. Bigger, brighter, better. Somebody praise him right here. Somebody praise him. Somebody praise him. Somebody pray. Oh, come on. Move that chair. Get him off that couch. And somebody go and praise him right here. Begin to praise him. Because God is sending bigger, brighter, better. Get ready now. Get ready now. Because expansion is coming. Strength is coming. I sense another wind. Hey, hey. I sense another wind. In this expansion, God's going to send you another wind. I need everybody on this line to go to praising God right here for another wind. We'll be right back. you ain't seen me.